So welcome to, on behalf of the Vota Coalition, I could say. My name is Jackie McKinney. I'm with Hartford 2000. And on behalf of the Vota Coalition, we'd like to welcome you to our mayoral candidate forum. In case you're wondering what the coalition is, it is a group of organizations whose primary purpose is to get people out to vote. We don't care what party you vote in. All we want you to do is to get out and vote. So, without further ado, we will begin our forum. You should also know that next week we'll be doing, is it next week? The city, next Thursday on the 22nd with the city council. We'll be doing a speed dating with the city council candidates. There's 14 of them. So come, it should be fun. And after that, we'll be doing also a forum with the treasurer and probate judge on the 28th. So a lot to do before we get to the first Tuesday in November.
We want to have someone walking out again, right?
Walking out from what? I'm not going to answer. No, everybody's here for the duration. I would like to introduce Barbara McGrath. She is going to be our moderator, and she will take us through the program. Barbara, she's like an old friend. We've known each other for a while. And she's the executive director of the Connecticut Urban Legal Initiative, CULI, at UConn. UConn, right? So without further ado, here's Barbara.
Thank you. You're supposed to hold your applause till the end. No, I'm kidding. Good evening, everybody. Linda asked me to do this when I finish my little intro. I'm going to go sit down over here. We're trying to accomplish a lot in a very short period of time. So I hope you'll all work with us. Veronica is helping me in the front row, telling me when the time is up for everybody. I'm going to briefly outline the plan. First of all, the candidates will each have a 3-minute opening statement. Then I'm going to be asking questions. Each time a question is answered, the first person to answer it will have 2 minutes to answer, and the other three will only have 1 minute, but then we'll circulate it. Each candidate will have the opportunity to be the 2-minute guy or woman for the next question. Then once we get through basically about 35 minutes of that, then you all will have questions. I ask you, please raise your hand. We have two folks who are gonna have microphones, and I'm gonna please ask you to make sure that these are questions and do your best to make them brief questions so that we can actually, much as we'd love to hear from you as well, we really are here to listen to the candidates this evening. And then there'll be a lightning round when each of them has to answer a question in one sentence, and all of you grammarians out there, we should worry about whether these are run-on sentences or not, so make sure you're listening very carefully. And then we're closing at 7:30, so we are trying to accomplish a lot in a very short period of time. So without further ado, I guess if we keep talking about ado all the time, I think we're going to go in reverse alphabetical order. So if I might ask Reverend Smith to be the first person to give her opening statement.
And you have 3 minutes.
Hello, everyone. I'm Reverend Patrice Smith. Well, actually, I'm Bishop Patrice Smith. I lived in Hartford all my life, 55 years. I've been here when downtown Hartford looked like downtown Hartford, when we had a whole lot of stores downtown and a whole lot of love and a whole lot of peace and a whole lot of people in our city. We had the G. Foxes and Sage Allen. And I decided to run for mayor because I have already decided twice that I wanted to run for mayor. I'm the last one on the tolling post because I wanted to actually see who is running. I care so much for my city that I cry for my city every night. I cry because of our crime, because of our taxes, for people who do not care about our city. I'm tired of our city going through what it's going through. We're going through rage and violence and no love, and there's no peace anymore. Everything is rooted. You got to understand that this city was founded on a great man. If you don't know who he is, I'm going to tell you who he is. He was founded on Reverend Hooker in the early days. So it was also founded on good people of God, okay? I'm not here to make you any promises. I'm not going to make you any promises I can't keep. But people, you have seen me up and down these streets for the last 30 years. I go from Park Street, I go from the North End, I go from the South End. I'm always in my community. I participate in everything that I have to do in this city. And I know that I can run this city because I have ran this city several times. I've worked with all the police chiefs. I have worked with all the mayors in the past. And I'm ready to work with the mayor who's gonna be the new mayor. I don't know who he's gonna be, but I'm ready to work with him. But I know I could make a change in this city. I'm the only lady that's running. Last time we had a lady who was Mayor Perry. I want to make a change. I really love Hartford. And I don't want it to die out. So that's why I decided that I would throw my hat in and run for it, because I really care about this city. And I know that I could make a change. And I thank you all for your time. And please look for me on the ballot, because now I'm here and I'm here to stay to the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we're going to ask Councilman Cruz if he'd like to make his opening statement.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Joel Cruz. I'm a Hartford City Council member, been a council member for the last 3 years and a half. Term started in 2012, and it ends this December 31st of 2015. Born and raised in the city of Hartford, I started at Barner Brown when it was Barner Brown. And I finally, when I got to high school, I graduated from Hartford High in 1998. Any Hartford High students here? Not many? Okay, just a little bit. Once I graduated from Hartford High, I joined the Marines. I left Hartford for 4 years. I was in Jacksonville, North Carolina, served in the Marines there for four, came back for the last four, served a total of 8 years in the Marine Corps. During that moment, you know, I'm also a youth pastor in the city of Hartford. I have two daughters. I have a 17-year-old who just became a senior. Please help me. and then I have a five-year-old who just started kindergarten. So one is finishing high school, the other one just beginning her school years. And if people are asking why am I running for mayor, it's as simple as, you know, I believe in the power of integrity. I believe in the power of accountability, but most importantly, I believe in the power of unity, of seeing one Hartford. I lived in many places in the city at that time. I really didn't like my parents moving so much, but now that I look back, I understand and I appreciate them moving so much, because I got to see, got to be exposed to diversity, and I got to appreciate what the city of Hartford brings, which is the power that it has with its diversity, the many neighborhoods and the languages that we speak in the city of Hartford. So whether I live in the South or I grew up in the North End, I don't see it as just I live on the North End of Hartford or I live in the South End of Hartford. I see it as one Hartford. When people ask me, where are you from? I say, I'm from Hartford. That's the place I'm from. So and so that's why I'm running. I'm running because I believe in our city. And most importantly, I don't have all the answers. So I won't come in here thinking I have all the answers. The answers lay between us, all of us. We have answers. We have the answers to how to make our city better. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you all for your enthusiasm. I just want to make sure that we try not to do too much clapping all the way through, or we're not going to be able to hear them as much. But I don't mean to quiet you, because I love the enthusiasm. This is all about voting. I understand that. Next, Mr. Cannon.
Thank you, Barbara. I'd like to thank Hartford Votes for sponsoring this event this evening. And just by virtue of the fact that you're all here tonight, I think you realize how important this election is and how seriously you are taking it. So I will thank you all for being here. Let me just tell you a little bit about myself. I lived in Hartford for 16 years. My wife and I and our oldest son moved here from New York. Upon moving here, we had three more children in fairly rapid succession. The oldest is now 22. He lives in Portland, Maine. And the other three are 16, 14, and 12, and obviously live here in Hartford with us. The 16 and 14-year-olds go to Sport and Medical Sciences Academy here in Hartford, and my 12-year-old daughter goes to the Metropolitan Learning Center. This is the only place they have ever lived, those three. And it's basically the only place they know. For them, it is the ultimate home. I've been asked a million times, why are you running for mayor? The answer is easy. It's because of them, to be honest with you. Not just my children, though, but all the children of Hartford. I want them to be proud of their city. I want them to have a safe, viable, happy place to live. And hopefully, at some point after they venture out, which I hope they do, okay, but at some point I would like them to say, you know what, I'm going back to Hartford and I'm going to make that my home. So, you know, it's part of me wants to see them fly the coop for a little while, but I know as soon as they do, I'm going to want them back. The Republican platform has a theme, and it's growth, okay? We are looking for growth in jobs, growth in opportunity, growth in educational excellence. It's something that Hartford has needed, I believe, for quite some time, and I think it's going to take some dramatic change and some dramatic decisions in order to achieve it. And I hope during the course of the questioning tonight, we touch on some of those issues that we are going to need to address. So thank you very much for being here, and I look forward to speaking to you more.
And Mr. Bronin.
Thank you very much, and good evening. And first, a thanks to the Hartford Votes Coalition for convening this. We've had a number of debates. Bishop Smith, it's wonderful to have you with us. I think this is, for some of us, our 15th debate or so. It's the first of the general election, though. And I wanted to say, you know, we've been through a long primary, but I'm so glad that Hartford Votes convened this debate, because even though the primary turnout was up by about 50% this year over the last election, it's still a tragically low fraction of our city that's voting. And I hope no matter who you're supporting, you encourage all of your friends to get out and vote, because the true way we're going to strengthen this city is by increasing the engagement in our political system. So I appreciate the coalition for convening it. I decided to jump into this race back in January because I believe that Hartford is at a crossroads. I think there are some good things happening here, and this is a great city, and we have incredible diversity. We have a great sense of community. When we are at our best, you know, we are a united city that's all pushing in the same direction. But we have huge challenges. You know, crime over the past 5 months has been devastatingly high. Our neighborhood schools need attention desperately. Parts of our city face great depression-level unemployment. And none of these are challenges that are going to be fixed overnight. But none of them are challenges that are going to be fixed at all without strong leadership. Because we have a system of government now that's a strong mayor form of government. And that means the mayor is no longer just a ceremonial position. The mayor's job is to manage City Hall, to make sure that he or she is holding people accountable and being willing to be held accountable. And I think some of the news and events of the last week, particularly as the Dillon Stadium project has unraveled and more information has come to light, has shown a lack of control, a lack of management, and a lack of accountability. And I think that's one illustration of why we need a firm hand that's focused on management. I also think that leadership needs to be more engaged in the community and in neighborhoods. I've tried throughout this campaign to get out and talk with as many voters as possible, at their doors, at their homes, on their phones, wherever I could. But I think it's important not just to campaign that way, but to govern that way. And one commitment I've made through this campaign, and I'll make it again tonight, is if I have the honor of being elected, I will hold a town hall once a month in a different neighborhood every month, where I get out and share what's going on, share my vision, my priorities, what I'm working on, and ask to hear from you. And I know those will not always be easy conversations, and they shouldn't be. But I hope to have that opportunity, and I look forward to the conversation tonight. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I would like to make just one clarification. The format this evening is not a debate. It's a forum. So we're going to ask a question, and each of you will get to answer it. But I would appreciate it if you'd be focusing your answers to the audience and not necessarily to one another. So with that, we have four areas of questions: public safety, education, economic development, and civic involvement. So we are going to start with Mr. Cannon on, is community policing important to the quality of life in Hartford?
Well, most certainly. Oh, excuse me.
Sorry, and you'll have 2 minutes, and then each of you will be able to answer that same question, but you'll each only have 1 minute. So, go, Veronica.
Okay, well, I think it's probably more accurate to say that safety is critical to,
the quality of life in Hartford.
Safety is critical to the quality of life in Hartford or any other city for that matter. The experts are telling us that community policing is the way to go. Boots on the ground, if you will, okay, as opposed to police just driving around in cars as sort of faceless people behind a steering wheel. And of course, we would like to have more police officers out there. The force has been depleted fairly dramatically, down about 75 or so, depending on who you talk to. But I don't think it's realistic to think that we are going to be able to increase the number of police officers very dramatically, at least for the foreseeable future. I think we would be lucky to be able to hire police officers at the attrition rate that we are going to see over the next several years. But as far as community policing goes, the police officers need to become part of the community, okay, and therefore have a direct effect on the quality of life that we so deserve. So,
thank you. Mr. Cruz.
Thank you. From my end, I'll take a different spin on it, because when we talk about community policing to increase or to better the quality of life, you know, we have to understand that aside from just having police officers or the boots on the ground, there's something that comes when we as a community or as neighbors take care of our streets, of our neighborhoods, where if I see something and you see something and the other one sees something, that we can come together and say that's not going to happen in our neighborhood, regardless of who's out there. So I think that's a lot more important. And secondly, that we understand that from the police department, aside from being from protecting, there's also a part that says serving. So helping us serve to have a better community, I think, is a better approach than just saying we need more police officers.
All right. Mr. Bronin.
I think community policing is critically important. I mean, just to step back and address the issue of public safety in general, I have on my website a plan that I've called the Safe Streets, Strong Neighborhoods Plan. There are 10 points in there. Public safety is not a simple problem to solve, and so I'd encourage you to take a look at the broader plan that I have there. But one piece of it is policing and is community policing. We do have a staffing problem in our city. You know, an independent study written last year said that the city of Hartford needs about 480 police officers to adequately police our city. We are currently around 395, and there are 40 officers who become eligible for retirement on November 1st. If even half of those take retirement, we're down to 375. It's not about arresting our way of a problem. It's about having a sufficiently large force that they can be part of the community, walking the beat, interacting face-to-face, knowing the neighborhoods and knowing the community. And again, it's critically important, but it's only one piece of the public safety puzzle.
Very good. Thank you. Reverend Smith.
Well, on my pamphlet that I have there, I have that we don't need any more police officers. I think we need less police officers. I think the police officers we have, we need to put them more to work. That's what we need to do. We don't need no more police officers in the city of Hartford. And as far as the community, I think the community need to step up with the police officers. When I was growing up, police officers were always in the street. I was on Albany Avenue. The police department used to walk with me. The police officers used to be around. We had the substations. I think it's sad that our substations are gone. We need to have left a substation on Albany Avenue. Now we don't have one. Now we have High Street. We have the police department. But as far as safety, that what people need to see more of. We need to see the community and the police officers walking down the street together. We need the citizen program. They used to have a citizen program. We need that program again. I took it up with the police department. We need to do that. We need to start caring about our own communities and always looking for somebody else to care for them for us. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next question, Mr. Bronin, you get to be first. What approaches would you consider implementing in order to improve the educational outcomes of Hartford students and to prepare them for higher education?
So I think the biggest challenge our school system faces right now is the fact that we have a multiple-tiered school system in which our neighborhood schools are facing some of the most severe challenges. In particular, the challenge of educating a very high percentage of children with special education needs and children who are English language learners. And I think we need to focus first, in order to improve outcomes for our kids, we need to focus first on helping working with our teachers and working with our schools to allow them to support those students in the greatest need at the schools in the greatest need. That's something that is reflected in the superintendent's plan, and I'm looking forward to working with her and try to push the implementation of that as aggressively and as quickly as we can. That, to me, is the most important thing we can do. We have, throughout the course of this campaign, had many discussions about Chef versus O'Neill, and I also believe we're at an important moment, not only because it seems like the negotiations between the Chef plaintiffs and the state have reached a difficult stage, but also because I think it's the right time. You know, we have built about 40-some magnet schools and spent a huge amount of money doing it, and the question is, from this point forward, what can we do most to ensure that we are providing an education to all of our kids? Because while the magnet schools have created many opportunities for many kids, more than half the kids in Hartford are still in those neighborhood schools. And I don't think we're going to build our way to better education outcomes across the board. I think we really need to focus on those challenges of special education and English language learning in particular.
Thank you. Next, Reverend Smith.
Our school system is so bad. We used to have, well, I'm not going to say that it's bad, but I'm just saying when I was going to school, I went to Bonnie Brown. We had teachers that care. We had different kind of teachers. We had teachers that would really come in here who had educated children, who didn't play with us as students. Now, we don't have enough teachers. We don't have enough black teachers. We don't have enough Spanish teachers. We have a lot of kids in our school who are not being taught. We have a high drop of kids dropping out of school who are just walking the streets, who are not getting education. So who teaching these kids? And why are they not more focused in school? We need training for the kids who got autism. We need training for kids who got special problems. We just need our teachers to be more trained too. And we need our board of education and our superintendents to start working with the parents and the community to help our children out more. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cannon.
Perhaps the most challenging issue the next mayor will face is educating our children. I mentioned in my opening remarks about how I want something for all the children of Hartford to be proud of and to stay here. But without a decent education system, I don't believe that's going to happen. We had a West End Civic Association meeting last night where the entire evening was devoted to education. 2.5 hours went by. We didn't even scratch the surface as to what needs to be done, and we covered a lot. The mayor is going to be appointing 5 members to the Board of Education almost immediately after taking office. I think it's extremely important that those 5 people be the right people for education of the superintendent's 5-year plan. And I also think we need to start considering, with regards to our neighborhood schools, the evaluation of each of those schools and possibly closing some of them.
Thank you. I will let people finish their sentence as long as they don't have a run-on sentence. Mr. Cruz.
Yeah, from my end, the first thing I will do is, if we talk about who are the folks who will be appointed to the Board of Education, the five that they just talked about, for me, I've been clear from the very beginning, there will be parents. I mean, we need parents to be in the Board of Education to have a bigger voice within the Board of Education. So that will definitely be parents from my end. The other piece is, you know, there's so much red taping even for our parents to be able to provide their children with the education that they deserve. So well, the first thing I will do is, you know, we need to work on the two systems, the two web systems that parents have to apply here and apply there. We combine them. The other thing we could do is that we provide all subjects to all kids, not just concentrate on one area. And so that's very important for us to take a look at and continue to work, not pinning the magnets against the community school and community schools against magnets. So let's stop doing all this division. Let's try to bring them together because it's all our kids.
Thank you. Next question. Thanks to the Vota Coalition, but the voting rate in Hartford is very low, especially compared to wealthier suburbs. So how would you choose to increase the number of Hartford residents who vote? And I'm going to ask Reverend Smith to be the first, please.
Well, what I've been doing, I've been going from community to community. They usually say I have a big voice because I'm a pastor and I don't really need a microphone. But I've been going from community, 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 and I've been bringing them in with me every single day. A lot of people said they have been waiting for, I guess it's a paper that you fill out on the back of the state paper. And they said they have been waiting for that paper. And when we took them in yesterday, the city said that that doesn't have anything to do with them because that's the state. We need to let people know this is how you vote for the city. And the best way for them to vote for the city, bring them down to City Hall and help them to register to vote. And that's what I did yesterday. I brought a whole bunch of people down and helped them to register. Let's just go from community to neighborhood and sign them up and show them how to fill out the cards that we got, Spanish and English, and show them how to vote. Because we have a lot of people in the city of Hartford who said they don't want to vote and they are not going to vote. So we need to bring them down here and show them how to vote. And their votes are important because there were people who died hundreds and hundreds of years ago to get votes. So we need to bring people in to get votes, and it's really important now with the candidates and the people that's running now to get these voters in right now so they can vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilman Cruz.
For this question and the answer to it, I will look at the folks who are here with me. The reason people don't vote, we don't give them enough hope, and they don't trust us. Why? Because we don't know how to behave in the public eye. We don't know how to really take on the public service piece. You know, we sit on these seats and we think, you know, it's really to give out favors and to bring nepotism into the city rather than looking at the people who elected us and doing our job from the first day we go in there to the last day we leave. The other thing we do is that we take these positions and we take them as careers and we don't want to leave. Once we're in there, we don't want to leave. And so people become just discouraged with politicians. And so it's up to us to be a people of integrity and accountability, and that when we say we're going to do something, we do it so we can build that trust with the people of Hartford.
Thank you. Mr. Bronin.
I think Joelle's exactly right. That there's too much hopelessness. No, there's too much hopelessness. There's too much sense that politics doesn't matter. That no matter who you vote for, nothing's going to change. And that once you elect somebody, you never see them. And that's why, again, going back to this commitment of mine, to continue to get out and talk with residents on a regular basis and in a different location at different times of the day, because not everybody can make an evening forum on a weekday night. But to make sure that we're trying to reach residents where they can be, where they can meet us and talk about what's at stake. I also think there are things we can do to push for changes in state law that will make it easier. You know, in a presidential year, this past year, you could register to vote on election day, but you couldn't do it in a municipal election. That doesn't make any sense and it's not right. We also pushed, when I was in the governor's office, pushed for a constitutional amendment to allow for early voting. No excuse, early absentee voting. You don't have to be sick, you don't have to be disabled. We should push for that again.
Thank you. Mr. Cannon.
Okay. Joel, did you just, you forgot to say present company excluded, right? When we have a one-party system in Hartford that we've had since 1971, the last time we've had a Republican mayor, Ann Usello. Okay, that's 44 years. Okay, we've had a Democratic mayor, Democratic city council. People come to election day and they say, we know who's gonna win, why should I bother going out and voting? That's one of the reasons that I am running this year, because I think Hartford needs a new voice, a different voice. I honestly believe we all want the same things, okay? But there are different ways of going about it. And I think those different ways need to be communicated to the people of Hartford, and they just haven't been over the last, well, quite some time, obviously. So.
Thank you. Question number four. We're gonna start with Councilman Cruz. What can city government do to entice young people to live and work in Hartford?
I like that question. Because I want my daughters to move at some point, but I mean, and no parent wants them to actually move out to a different state where you don't get to see them. You know, it's going back to the basics. One of the things that I remember even growing up in the city of Hartford is that, you know, I didn't know that you had council members in the city of Hartford. And maybe it's my ignorance. So, okay, so call me ignorant if you want to. But no one ever exposed me to that. So the way we can keep people in our city is by helping our young people feel proud of where they live. And you do that by exposing them to giving them the civic engagement that's needed, but also helping them understand what it means to municipalities and the city government, and exposing them to that. At the city, as a council member, from the time I started there, I've always brought fifth graders from different schools and giving them an opportunity to meet all the department heads so the department heads could share with them, where did you go to school? How did you become an attorney? I didn't know you could be an attorney and work for a corporation council. I didn't know you could be an architect and work for DPW. You know, a lot of times all we know is that we have the fire department, so you could be a firefighter or you could be a police officer. But did you know you could be a forester and work for DPW? And so these are the things that we must create by enhancing our internships and giving our kids an opportunity to see what Hartford is all about. When you have passion for something and people expose you to it, you tend to stick around a lot longer because it's something that's passionate that you feel, so.
Thank you. Mr. Cannon.
Well, Joel's right, but working for the city of Hartford should not be the only alternative to young people, okay? We need to create more jobs, and it's somewhat of a misnomer because the city actually doesn't create the jobs. The city creates an atmosphere that is conducive to private investment coming in and creating jobs. Okay, that's something that we have not been doing for a very, very long time. And then, of course, if you want to raise a family, you might consider someplace other than Hartford because our educational system is in need of improvement. So, we need to create an atmosphere that our children, I mean, I said it in my opening statement, that I want to create an atmosphere where my children say, I want to come back home and live. And, that's going to take a while, but I firmly believe that we can get it done.
Thank you. Mr. Bronin.
Jobs are number one. Beyond that, it's getting back to the basics. It's being a city that takes quality of life seriously. It's being a city that has a city government that responds to neighborhood needs. It's making sure that we are a city that is safe and is perceived as safe by those who live here, no matter what neighborhood you're in. It's being a city where we all share in the incredible cultural assets that we've got in this city. There's no grand solution to keeping people here. How many people do we all know who got one of those jobs, you know, working in City Hall, working as a firefighter, and then moved their family out to Windsor, out to Bloomfield? We all know so many people. So many of those people still feel a love for the city of Hartford, and they didn't want to leave necessarily. We've got to be a city that gets back to basics so that there's no reason that people say, I want to pick up and leave.
Well, I'm a Hartford native. I've been here 55 years, like I said, all my life. I was born and raised in the city of Hartford. They have tried to get me to leave several times. Let's go down south, or let's go somewhere else. My mother been here ever since she was 18. She's 78 now. She don't want to leave Hartford, so if she's not going to leave Hartford, I'm not going to leave Hartford. So I have been in Hartford all my life. I love the city of Hartford. It is so many opportunities in the city of Hartford, but we get so many outsiders who come in and get our jobs and take away from our children and take away from the people that's here. We got so many commuters that's out there who come in and take our jobs. We don't have enough jobs in the city of Hartford because everybody else got them. We need them to come back in the city of Hartford. I was working at City Hall when I was 15 years old. When I was 12, 13 years old, I had a job. So I always worked in the city of Hartford all my life. Listen, there are jobs out there. Amazon is hiring, they need 700 people. Jobs are over here, jobs are over there. We just need to get online and help these young people who don't have that education, to give them that education to help them to find a job and educate them.
Thank you. All right, the next question is going to be directed first to Mr. Cannon, and that is, what responsibility does city government have for assuring that refugees and immigrants feel welcome in our community and have opportunities for participating in civic life?
That's a good question. I was on the Hartford Housing Authority's website earlier today, and I was a little disturbed to learn that waiting list for 1, 2, and 3 bedroom affordable housing units have been closed, okay? One of them for over a year now, okay? I think we are lacking in some of the just the basic needs that people need. I mean, people need housing, people need jobs, people need decent education. These basic services that are necessary to welcome immigrants into our city are lacking, and that's something that I believe that. And I think everyone is going to agree that we need to improve on. We don't have enough jobs for them when they get here. We don't have housing. Our education's lacking. So those are all the things that we need to make significant improvement in to make people welcome here.
Thank you, Reverend Smith. Mr. Bronin?
Our immigrant communities in the city of Hartford are a huge part of the city's strength, cultural strength, but also economic strength. We have a history of a rich history of immigrant communities establishing Hartford as their home, growing, and becoming economic and cultural drivers of our city. We should embrace that. It makes any city stronger. We have right now. I mean, we have, in addition to we have growing communities from Central America. We have a strong Albanian community, Bosnian community. We have a Karen community from Burma that's growing in our city. So many communities. We have the third largest West Indian population in the entire country. All of these communities are a part of the strength of our city. All of them also bring tremendous economic opportunity if we can promote. Promote that community, support entrepreneurs within that immigrant community in establishing businesses that can then employ Hartford residents. It's been part of the success of Hartford throughout history. It should be part of our success now and into the future.
Thank you. Councilman Cruz.
From my end, it's because of this question that I help introduce the Immigration, Refugee, and Migration Commission in the city of Hartford, and they've been doing amazing work. I mean, every time I get an opportunity to see them at work, they're just doing some amazing work. And I introduced that commission because I understood the power of being able to have an open door with our migration families. And so it's important that not just taking on that role for the city of Hartford, but there's plenty of entities in the city of Hartford as well, nonprofits who are doing amazing work, like International Hartford, and there's also Catholic Charities who are doing some great work with our migration and refugees community. So not just us taking on the task, but also partnering up with other entities and being able to work together for the betterment of our communities.
Thank you. Reverend Smith, would you want to take a turn now?
I just wanted to marinate on that question a little while. You know how when you marinate stuff and keep it in the refrigerator all night, it tastes better? So I had to marinate on that question for a minute, because I don't understand. We have immigrants. We have different races of people in the city of Hartford. But why is the city of Hartford so poor? Why are we in poverty? Why don't we have anything really to give these people? They come over here, but really, really don't have anything for them. They might have a lot of programs, but where do they find these programs? I work with so many African families that even go to our schools. They have so many problems that they can't get enough food over here. So why can't they get enough food, or they can't get insurance, or why they can't get things over here? I think these people need to find out where these programs are, like Joel was saying, and find out what's going on with the immigrants and the different people that come to our city, and we need to help them. But we need to also help the people that's already in our city.
Thank you. All right, this next question. What are your opinions of charter schools, magnet schools, and school vouchers as educational options for Hartford children? And I'm going to start with Mr. Bronin.
My opinion on all of those is that they are not the solution to the structural problem that we have in our education system. I don't think charter schools are evil. I don't think magnet schools are should be blamed for our problems. I don't think vouchers are the answer. But fundamentally, I think those approaches to solving the fundamental education system problems avoid the central problem, which because so often those schools are able to serve a population in which there is some amount of self-selection or some amount of active managing of the student population to achieve different results. That's not true in all cases. There are exceptions to that. But fundamentally, I think we have to address the core challenge of strengthening our neighborhood schools. I also think neighborhood schools are not just about education. They're also about community. They're also about economic development. You need to have schools around which a community can grow, around which there's a sense of common ownership, you know, that attract families to move into a neighborhood or to stay in a neighborhood because they know those schools are good. And there has to be some amount of certainty and reliability about where your kid is going to go to school. And so I do not demonize anybody who supports any part of the answer to improving education for kids. But I believe that if we're going to focus on the answer's got to be strengthening the core public school system.
Thank you. Mr. Cannon.
I'm a little bit biased. I have three children in magnet schools. They are part of the educational success that we have realized in Hartford. And I don't think that we should take away from those successes, okay? We're supposed to build on them, in my opinion. I agree 100% with Luke about neighborhood schools. More than half of our students go to neighborhood schools, and yet they are funded at ridiculously low levels relative to magnet schools, not just here in the city, but CREC schools, for example. It's an unintended consequence, but nevertheless, if you have to go to a neighborhood school, you are at something of a disadvantage in terms of the resources available for your education. So, there we go.
Thank you. Mr. Cruz.
This is really a question that, with an opinion, it really has come from a parent. And so I will speak as a parent on this question. And from my end, it's important to understand I went through the educational system in the city of Hartford when we had no magnets or no charter schools. But it's important to understand that parents have that choice. And for me to demonize any school system, it's wrong for me, because you will find parents in the charter schools that will say, that's the school that I chose for my kids, and I will never take that away from our kids. But the important piece is that we make it equitable for all our kids, whether you're in a magnet school, a community school, or a charter school, where you have enough, you know, good balance of ELL students, and you have a good balance of children with disabilities. Like, that will have a better approach. And again, look, the chef was trying his best, because we knew we had some problems. But that's not the end of it all. We can still have conversations right now to improve our educational system.
Thank you. Reverend Smith.
I agree with you, Joel. Our public schools, we didn't have, when I was growing up, we didn't have public schools. I mean, you know, charters and other schools where we could leave and go out of town. We had to deal with the schools that we had. And I think our public schools were really good. I mean, we had good educational background. I mean, it's good now that these kids can be bussed out, though. Some of the kids, I see some people looking like, well, but it is good that some of these kids could be bussed out, because a lot of them not with their friends anymore. You know, and they need to have a good education, so sometimes it takes you to go out to different places. I wish I could have went out to different places when I was younger, but I didn't get that chance. So even with the magnet schools, we having a lot of dropouts, but I think magnet schools are great. I think the correct school is great. I think they got more opportunities now to get a good education, so they should try to go in. And with the lottery thing, that what gets me, though. I think it's sad that a kid who want to go to a good school have to wait for a lottery before he can get it into a good school. Now, that what bothers me, because there are kids who want to get into these good schools, but they can't get into them because of the lottery. Thank you.
All right. We are getting close to, we have a couple more questions, and then we're going to move on to the next part here. So I'll try to make sure I get some good questions here for you. Overall, in the United States, more people are employed in small businesses than in large corporations. What can be done to encourage small businesses to move into Hartford and to stay here? And the first answerer will be Reverend Smith.
Well, today, you know, I'm glad you asked me that, because today I had that kind of day. I went and talked to a lot of business owners that were in the city of Hartford, and they was wondering why, that who would ever be the next mayor, why don't small business owners get grants? Why don't anybody fund them and help them to be able to stay here? We have a new store that opened up on Barber Street, and I went up and talked to him. He said that he really want to make his laundromat more than what it is. He said he just don't want it to be a laundromat, but he want people to be able to come in and get an education. He want computers in there. He want training in there. He want people to come out so they can own their own laundromats, so they can have their own businesses, so they can grow in the city of Hartford. He want them to, if they come from the city of Hartford, and he want to know why he already went to the previous mayor and he have went to different people, but he can't get the funding. So how do we, as small business owners, how do they get the funding? How do they survive up against these big businesses if nobody won't support them with fundings or won't give them a grants? So this is the problem that the small business owners are having. You have so many small businesses now who can't grow because nobody won't support them with the grants. They want to stay in the city of Hartford, but the taxes. The taxes are so high, they cannot survive. So they asked me to even ask a few people tonight who is running. Would they come up there to help them out, to give them some information so they can give back to our community, so they can give jobs to our community and help out more in our community? And these are small business owners that's in the north end and in the south end of Hartford. We need to fund our small business communities and help them out so we can have more jobs in our city.
Thank you. Councilman Cruz.
From my end, the very first thing is a mural rate, but keep in mind that every one mural rate represents about $3.5 million in the city of Hartford of revenue. So when you lower the mural rate, then you're going to have to find those 3.5 somewhere else to cover other areas like the police department, fire department, and DPW, all these other departments, and the services that are provided to the city. And I don't share that to say that we shouldn't be having that conversation, because I've said from the beginning we have not had enough conversation about bringing down our mill rate. So our mill rate is definitely our number one. But the second one is creating incentives for our small businesses. And I've shared this before, where we could provide incentives for our small businesses by, if they hire ex-offenders or returning citizens, that we will give them a tax break, just like we do with big businesses in the city of Hartford when they're asking for tax breaks. Why don't we do the same for our small businesses? And at the same time, we're able to address the ex-offenders population.
Thank you. Mr. Cannon.
There are quite a few federal and state programs to encourage small businesses, and they've been very active in the city of Hartford. However, small or large, it doesn't matter. Our tax code is just, it's so discouraging to businesses. I mean, to have, a 70% assessment ratio on top of a 74.29 mill rate, I mean, not to be facetious, but, you know, we might as well just hang up a sign and say business is not welcome. I mean, who is going to be able to open a business, let alone maintain one, with that kind of tax structure? So that's a whole another story in terms of the challenges facing the city. The tax structure has to be addressed, and we have to get cooperation from not just homeowners but our major commercial property owners as well.
Thank you, Mr. Bronin.
So everyone up here has talked about taxes as a key part of the problem and the solution, and it's exactly right. You know, when a small business can move one town over and cut their taxes by 60%, we're going to have trouble retaining small businesses. We're going to have trouble growing small businesses. So the question is, what do you do about that? I've talked about three things that we have to do over the long term to get our taxes under control, to stop the growth in taxes, and to begin bringing down the mill rate. Number one, we've got to be more effective advocates for ourselves at the state level. A huge percentage of Hartford's property is non-taxable. More than half the property in the city of Hartford is non-taxable because it's non-profit. We have to work with the state in a coalition and with our delegation to change the way we're reimbursed for that. As we do that, we have to manage our own house better, because we can't go up and ask for more for the state if there are headlines in the paper about mismanagement in our own city hall. And number three, we've got to promote growth, and we've got to do it in ways that don't depend on subsidies that take away all the long-term upside of the tax bill.
Thank you very much. You guys are squeezing a lot in here. Okay, I think that this is probably maybe our last question in this round. So I'm going to start with Councilman Cruz. In your opinion, what are some of the root causes of the increases in violence and homicides that Hartford has been experiencing? And what do you think the role of city government should be in addressing this increase?
So in 2007, I lost my best friend to gun violence in the city of Hartford. And I'm sure if I ask people here in this room, raise your hand if you lost someone to gun violence, I think more than half of the people in this room, sadly, would raise their hand. And I would share with even some folks in this room that violence in the city of Hartford did not start happening in 2015, okay? It did not. When I was growing up, I remember the Solidos and the Latin Kings and the 20 Love and then the Baby Solids and the Baby Latin Kings, and everywhere you look, you had gangs and you have violence. So when we talk about the violence in the city of Hartford and how are we gonna address the violence in the city of Hartford, it is important that we go back to the word community. We do, because it's really about my brother's keeper. That if I know Ted, and Ted knows me well, I'm gonna have a harder time just taking his life. But that doesn't happen in the city of Hartford. I can live next to someone and never get to know them. So by creating opportunities for people to get to know each other and strengthening even within the NRZs, where we can get folks to get to know each other, that's really the answer to the violence in the city of Hartford. So again, I want to remind folks that although now violence has become like the number one topic, hello, it's been happening for over more than 20 years. My father came here in 1967, and as far as he can remember, there were violence in the city of Hartford. But let's look at each other, and let's say, what are we going to do as a community and come together and say no more to the violence in the city of Hartford?
Thank you. Mr. Bronin.
I don't think anybody can take somebody else's life unless they've lost a sense of hope and lost a sense of worth and the dignity of human life. And I don't think that happens unless they've lost any sense that the future could be brighter. We have a city, as I said at the beginning, where some neighborhoods have over 27% unemployment, where some people will struggle for their entire lifetime to find a job because of a mistake that they made some years ago, where too many families are stuck in generations of severe poverty, and the school system hasn't given them the tools to escape from that cycle. So we need to address the problem of public safety and violence by getting at all of those root causes. Again, I encourage you to take a look at the plan that I put out. We need to make sure that we are not suspending more kids from school than any other town in the city of, in the state of Connecticut, because that puts up kids on a path to failure. We need to make sure that we're not accepting the fact that there's rampant absenteeism in our schools. We need to make sure that we're serious about a second chance so that people aren't left without hope for so long.
Thank you. And Reverend Smith.
Boy, I've been doing gang violence and violence, just violence, for over 30 years of my life or more. Violence has not just started just now. Violence has started years ago, since biblical days. Let's just get back to the violence, okay? When Abel killed Cain, now we're going all the way back. There's always been violence. But as far as the city of Hartford, first of all, when they stripped you parents of you right, your rights, okay? We used to get beatings, and we knew we was going to get butt whoopings, and so we already knew we wasn't going out there and committing no crime or bothering nobody. And when we fought in the days, you took the rock off my shoulder, I took the rock off your shoulder, and that was it, okay? And we was friends later on. He's absolutely right. They had the ghetto brothers. I grew up with Mayor Perez. So Mayor Perez and my brother used to fight all the time, but they the best of friends, and they still grow up to be the best of friends. Yes, we had gang violence long, long time ago, okay? But still, there's things that can be done in the city of Hartford to stop this violence. We need to take our city back as a community and be our brother's keeper and be that village again that we used to be and help raise our children back and stop being scared of them.
Thank you very much. Mr. Cannon.
Thank you. Well, when you asked the question, I thought to myself, you know, there's going to be four different answers, and they'll all be correct, because there are so many issues that are creating the violence. I recently spoke to a class at Hartford High School, their Law and Government Academy, and the subject of violence came up, and we talked about, you know, gangs and ex-offenders and so forth. And the message that I got from the students, these were all seniors, was that we need to determine why kids want to become part of gangs to begin with. And that will give you a reason why some of this violence occurs. Because they need a sense of belonging, a sense of respect, a family atmosphere, if you will, that they are lacking sometimes in their own personal lives, that that would go a long way to keeping them on the straight and narrow and preventing them from engaging in this.
Thank you very much. All right, now it's your turn to ask questions. Yeah. We're gonna take a very quick break. But so let me explain the rules.
Oh, they're
rule.
Back.
Okay. They're oh my. Back. So okay. So I'm because Alyssa has already jumped up and is standing up. We're gonna let Alyssa ask the first question, but it must be brief and to the point.
Okay, that's going to be impossible. Good evening, and thank you all for showing up. It's very important. This question is for Mr. Bronin, and then all of you can follow up. Mr. Bronin, we had a chance to see you over the last 4 months because of a primary. You ran on a platform of accountability. Quite honestly, my opinion is you reek of accountability. That's what I've learned over these last several months. But you also ran with a slate of candidates. And you ran saying you were all accountable. And my concern is that those candidates have failed or to show up in a forum like this.
Can you make sure
what
you
can
ask
you
the
do?
Question?
What can you do as a Democrat, and what would you other candidates of other parties do to encourage candidates like Adam Cloud or Foy Smith to come and appear here at the forums so we can simply ask them some questions if members of the community have them? We really need to know what other members on your slate are going to do. Thank you.
I do and will encourage them. You know, I as we said, you know, I think this is our 15th or 16th forum, and I am glad of every single one, because I think the more conversations we can have, the more people get to hear it, the better. You know, I say there are many people in the audience tonight who have been at many of the debates, but there are also a number of people who haven't been at any, and I'm excited about that. I will certainly encourage everybody on my slate and everybody who wants to run for anything to get out and take advantage of every opportunity to have a conversation about the issues and explain why they think they're the right candidate for the job.
Thank you. Would any of the rest of you like to respond in any way?
First of all, thank you for that question. I think from my end, I don't have a slate, but the important piece, and you know, sometimes I'm glad I don't, because the important piece is that, you know, we have a city where we get so complacent with just saying vote row A. Well, can we vote on integrity and character of the people who are running rather than just voting for one line? I mean, that's really what it's all about when it comes to voting. I mean, when I want to vote, I vote for the person that's going to do the job, not based on like, oh, well, this one's with this one, so I'm going to stay and I'm just going to vote. I encourage everyone to look at everyone who's running, whether you're on row A, row B, or row 2E, and look for the person who's going to do the job rather than just voting for everyone on the line.
Thank you. Do either of you have anything to say on this one? Or?
No, I say lead by example. I mean, I have slate members here tonight, and I would certainly, I mean, I promise I am going to participate or come to their forums when their opportunity comes. I mean, we're here to support each other, so that's it, you know.
Thank you. Why don't we ask this gentleman here to have ask a question?
Ed.
Hold on one second. Wait for the microphone.
I would like to know how this whoever gets a mayor could change their license and inspections. We had two fires in an empty building on Sisson Avenue just recently. It's not funny. I call LNI. They don't do the work. I mean, they don't answer your question. So I would like to know, through Luke Brennan and all of you, how could you change this LNI? I know
you.
In other cities, it's easier to get a blighted building changed. But that's not the only question.
Thank you, sir. That's a great question.
That's not the only question.
I know, but you only get one question. One question at a time, okay? Please, we just have to share. You've got other people here. Mr. Cannon?
Eddie, I agree with you 100%. Blight is a huge issue in the city. It drags down property values all around it. It's unsafe, unhealthy. We need more inspectors. And that's, I mean, look, I'm running in part on a platform of fiscal conservatism, but that's one area that I could consider spending some additional money and hiring more inspectors and getting rid of the blight in this city. It's I think out of control, and The sad thing is the city is probably the biggest, cause of it. Luke mentioned Dillon Stadium earlier. I'm around there a lot because my kids go to school near there. And it's really kind of disgusting, to be honest with you. So we need to clean the place up.
Thank you. Councilman Cruz?
Yeah, I wanted to say that when it comes in regards to parcels, the city of Hartford alone has about 181 parcels that are empty with nothing in them, that are blighted themselves. So I think we need to take care of our house first before we start looking at someone else. And I want to say, Ed, in the 3 years that I've been in the council, he shows up to every council meeting. Every council meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bronin?
Yeah, just to address your question directly, it gets back to the issue of leadership and management. You know, prevention is much more effective than trying to fight a fire after the fact. And we've seen so many fires in our city increase dramatically this year. And a part of the problem is that there have been inadequate inspections. You need to have a team that's willing to come in and tell you the bad news. So if they're not able to do the inspections that they need to know that they're expected and empowered to come in and say, we're not coming anywhere close to where we need to be. And if public safety is a priority, then we need to fix it. Maybe that's a question of resources. Maybe it's a question of reallocating existing resources. But if it's a problem that puts lives in jeopardy, you have to address it. I also think in my economic development plan, which is also on the website, blight and abandoned property is a huge part of that. And we have to be much quicker at addressing the blighted properties around our city, many of which are city-owned, but some are not. And we can use other authorities, whether it's using our tax liens or condemnation, to make sure that we are forcing a change where there's blight.
Reverend Smith, did you want to answer that also?
Well, I like to say now, and I'm not telling everybody my business, but I live in a building right now that's collapsed, okay? We have complained about this building so many times to the inspectors. The landlord had 43 citations. The building is collapsed, okay? So they moved us out of the building. So I'm not living in the building right now. So I can answer this question because this is the way I feel now. Over and over and over again, we have called inspectors, the city inspectors. We have tried to get to the mayor. Nobody's helping us. We're just out of the loop right now. They're not even worried about us, but we're fine. We're fine. But we have a $15 million Dillon Stadium or more than that over there that is not finished being built up. You have so many projects that's going on in the city of Hartford. So what about all the blighted buildings that's already here that could be built up? Why you keep sticking our money, our taxpayer money, into other projects and other properties while we already have all these buildings that need to be fixed up over again?
Thank you very much. Okay, we have a number of people. Hold on 1 second. You get to be next, and then you, and then the woman in the way back, and then the woman in that way back, okay? We're going to start with those four, okay? And we'll see how much further we can go. Yes.
Thank you. My question is for Mr. Bronin. I want to know, what are your expectations, or what do you plan to do as far as the education? Because from my research, I understand that your children go to a private school, but you want to come and run our city, and you're saying you got all these ideas as far as education, but your kids don't even attend the schools here. And so that's a concern as a citizen, as a resident of Hartford. So if you can answer that question, like, I'm just confused of, why your kids go to a private school, and, you're trying to run for mayor and, all the other good things. So answer that, that'd be great.
Sure. So, my wife and I believe deeply in Montessori education, especially for young kids, and we believe it's right for our kids. My kids are 6, 4, and 2, and I think Montessori is right for them. We tried a couple of years in a row to get our daughter into Montessori school through the lottery and failed, and found the lottery process very tough to navigate, very frustrating. And I think that's an experience that a lot of Hartford parents share. So first of all, I think that experience actually gives me some insight into the frustration that many parents feel in dealing with that process. But secondly, I want to do everything that I can to give my children every opportunity they can, and I want to do everything I can to give every Hartford kid every opportunity that they deserve. So I don't think there's anything inconsistent about wanting to do what's right and best for my kids and wanting to do what's right and best for all of Hartford's kids, which I think you do by strengthening our neighborhood schools.
Thank you. I'm not sure, since that was directed directly to him, we're going to go on to the next question. Oops.
Benefits. Health insurance versus health savings accounts, pensions versus 403Bs, benefits for part-time workers. What's your opinions on that?
Okay. Anybody have an answer to that question? Let's start with Mr. Cannon and then Councilman Cruz.
Okay. We have a chronic $40 million, $50 million a year budget deficit for the last several years. The mayor has been talking about we have a revenue problem. Well, he's half right, okay? We do have a revenue problem, but we also have a spending problem. And until we address both sides of that equation, we're not going to solve our budget deficit issues. And one of the spending issues is most certainly the idea of benefits for our municipal unions. Now, it's easy to just talk about it and say, okay, well, we're going to change the format of our pension system and our benefits and OPEB and everything else. Obviously, this all is part of the bargaining process, but it is an issue that absolutely it's becoming a bigger and bigger part of our annual budget.
Okay. Thank you.
I got my point across. Yeah.
From my end, I think it's important that even as a city, when we have, because you're talking about city employees, right? Is that correct? Okay, so as far as it goes for city employees, I think it's important that the city of Hartford becomes an example when it comes to providing the right benefits, whether you're full-time or part-time. But again, it goes back to the lack of revenue it's either entering, but there's also just so much spending in the city of Hartford. I share a couple times in this last budget cycle, we had to appropriate $5 million from different departments to cover the police department and the fire department because they went over their overtime by $5 million. And there's so much you can do with $5 million. There's so much you could do with $1 million with the different services that we have. So I truly believe in really keeping our expenditure to a healthy level and being able to cover for part-time workers so they can take care of their families.
Thank you. Would either of you like to respond? Mr. Bronin.
Yeah, look, I think providing retirement security is an important part of the bargain that's struck with public sector workers. I think very often, a 401k or similar programs are cited as the solution. It's important to remember that a lot of the liabilities that we've got and a lot of money that we've got to put aside every year is not to fund current pensions that are accruing, but to fund the past liability that's already there, the promises that have been made to workers who came before. And what's important to me is that we honor those promises. So I think you have to be careful, because if you were to make a switch, you would have to continue to fund the defined benefit plan at time that you're switching over and diverting the compensation of current employees into 401ks. We have to make sure that, let me just do the flip side of this, we have to make sure that the promises we're making are sustainable. It's not a good bargain for anybody if you make promises that can't actually be met. So I think we need to honor the obligations we've made, and we need to make sure that we're being serious and clear-eyed about the commitments we make in the future.
Okay, thank you. Reverend Smith, did you want to answer that? Okay. In the back.
Hello. The question is for Joel Cruz. I hear you say a lot about accountability, and I know that working families, they make up most of the city council. There's a lot of backdoor deals being made off of the backs of our residents. When can we hold you guys accountable?
Thank you for that question. I will first just bring some clarification. The working families is not the majority in the city council. It's really the Democratic Party, but because I'm not here to either point fingers one or the other way, accountability starts with the person itself first. People have seen that when I'm at City Hall, I hold myself accountable for my actions, and if I make a vote that the people of Hartford feel it was the wrong vote, because as a leader, sometimes you're gonna make certain decisions that you're gonna look back and say, oh, I should have gone this way. I will hold myself accountable and go in front of you and say, you know what, I made a mistake. And that's the difference, that at City Hall, you have a lot of people there who go in and they never wanna admit to their mistakes. And it's important for us to admit to our mistakes. So I will hold myself accountable to that.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We gotta. You can speak with him afterwards. That would probably be a good opportunity. Over in that corner. Thank you.
Yes, panel. As you know, soon we are getting the release of the federal prisoners. What do you have as far as how are they going to house these people? And you talked about gangs, okay? You talked about gangs, and how do you know these people aren't going to retaliate? How do we know that these people are not going to go back to their same crime? How do we know that, you know, they get a second chance? What criteria, what protocols are you taking so that we are safe in the community? Do they have a housing? So what are you all gonna?
Thank you.
Start.
That's a great question. Go ahead, Mr. Bronin.
It is a great question. My understanding, although I'm not sure, my understanding is that of the federal inmates that are going to be released, a very small number are coming to Connecticut. I think it's in the 30s. But every single year, more than 1,000 people are released back into the city of Hartford. So it's not just a question of this particular release from federal prison. It's a challenge that we face every single day in the city of Hartford. I think the number was between 2013 and 14, I think 2,300 people returned to Hartford from prison. And that's why I've talked a lot throughout this campaign about a second chance society. And there are things I think we can do at the state level, at the city level, to complement what's been done at the state level. One thing I've called for is an office, for a reentry office. The city of New Haven has one. It helps be a resource for those who are coming back to understand what options and opportunities are available to them. We also need to work with work training sites and with programs and with employers that are willing to employ ex-offenders and encourage them to expand those efforts. We need to lead by example in City Hall, and we need to encourage others to join us in that effort.
Thank you. Reverend Smith?
Well, I think we need to go into the jail systems like we do. A few of us, I go into the jail systems, and I talk to them all the time, the commissioner and the warden and them, and ask these young men, because I think we need to put the scared straight back in the city of Hartford, because a lot of these kids need to be scared straight. Listen, first of all, let's get real. They're coming back to their corners, okay? They're coming back to this community, and they're coming back for violence. What's theirs, they think they own the city of Hartford, so they're coming back to the city of Hartford and claim what's theirs. So first of all, we need to go back up there to the higher thing. Listen, this is how it is, people. If you don't get to the root of situations, it's just like a weed. It keep growing back and growing back and growing back, right? And until you cut the head off, that's the only time it's not gonna grow no more. We're gonna have crime. We're gonna have people coming back and forth out of them jail doors like it's a revolving system until somebody really put their foot down and say, listen, the jail system is not a business. Right now it's a business. They coming in there for a bed, a hot, and a cot. So we need to start training and educating our people to let them know more, stop going into the jail systems, and house them better.
Thank you, Reverend.
Yeah, briefly, quite honestly, I don't see the difference between the people who already live here and the double-digit unemployment that we have in Hartford and new people coming into the city that are going to be unemployed and don't have proper housing. I just don't see the difference, quite honestly. It just adds to the numbers. We have to do the same things for the new people coming in as we would like to do for the people who already live here. I mean, as I said, double-digit unemployment, okay? Poverty, like you read about, okay? Bringing more people into the city doesn't mean we're going to do something completely new and dramatic. I think we need to take care of the people who already live here first, quite honestly.
Thank you. Councilman Cruz?
Yes, thank you. So, you know, from my end, my brother-in-law is an ex-offender, and for a long time he was in and out of jail, in and out of jail. And the last time he came out, what helped for him is he got an opportunity to actually go to school and finish his education. That's very key. Because once he was able to complete his education, then he had an opportunity to work. And he became a barber. And it kept him busy to right now. You know, he's doing very well. He has not gone back to jail. So I think it's important that we continue to build on the opportunities and the support system that, because a lot of them, you know, we could talk about saying, oh, they're coming out of jail. A lot of them are brothers and sisters and uncles and aunts and cousins. And so as a community, we can provide the support system that they need so they don't go back to that vicious cycle.
Thank you. The gentleman over there in the hat.
My question is this. I've been living in Hartford since 1974. I live behind a school, and all around, on the four corners of the school, there's not one sign that says, this is a school zone. Also, my street became a race street. And if it was for Councilman Cruz, it still would be a race street. You could not get out of your house because people speed, people went both ways, there was no room. They remodeled the school, the village school. And I don't know whose responsibility it is for the safety of the children and the safety of the residents their school.
So your question.
That's the question.
How would they address that issue?
How are they going to address the issue? I mean,
thank you.
There is no sign, there is nothing.
That's a great question.
So I will share what the process right now. The process right now is that, you know, a conversation will be going to the traffic division of the city of Hartford, and they will do a traffic study. Now, this is a challenging piece, and I share this at one of the NRZs, because I'm not going to come in here and give promises that, no, you know, the city of Hartford can't keep. And so one of the pieces that we're missing is that we don't even have a traffic division person. And so the one who's doing it, that's not even part of his job description. He's doing it because there are folks who are saying people are speeding through my street. So the first thing that will happen is that there will be a traffic study. If the traffic study shows that more than 60% of the cars are going 35 miles and more, then the petitioning will start within the community to get speed humps. And that even that process takes long, because there's even streets of folks, people in these certain streets that are waiting still for the traffic study, just so they can prove that people are speeding in the streets.
Thank you.
I'll just add briefly, sir, to Joelle's comments, it needs somebody to report that speeding that's going on, okay? And that's where the community comes in. You know, we really should be all looking out for each other, and so, you know, to have somebody report that to the police department or the school or what have you would go a long way.
Thank you.
Okay. That's great. Thank you. That's great.
Would either of you want to respond to that question? Yes,
go ahead. I hear from residents all the time with similar issues, and I think the complaints are made very regularly. One of the things that's also missing is enforcement. And, you know, I don't want to get any speeding tickets, and I probably am guilty of it once in a while, but I think we need to enforce our quality of life rules, and that's speeding, and that's litter, and that's noise ordinances. All of that contributes to quality of life. And so, you know, I can't tell you how frustrating it is sometimes to me when I see a police car sitting and an obvious traffic violation happens right in front, because I think when there isn't enforcement, it sends a message that it just doesn't matter. And I don't think that's the right message to send to the city of Hartford, even if it means I get a ticket once in a while.
Hold on.
I don't want to make the city of Hartford look too bad, because there are, in different places, there are signs up that tell us about 35, the limit. And there are different parts of Hartford where they have the zoning. and different places. So there are things in Hartford that tells you, and there are a lot of places that have the bump, but it's true about enforcing these rules. You have to enforce these rules. You have to be somebody in the community, like he was saying, who comes out and tell them what's going on in your community. If you're having people speed around, or it's not only just the speeding, it's people texting. That's a horrible thing. I see people texting and not even paying attention to people going across the street. So it's a whole bunch of things, the drugs, the speeding, the ticketing. So it's a lot of things, sir. But we're going to work on them. We're not going to make promises, but we're going to work on them. Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to take one more question, and then we're going to go with the closing lightning round. Yes, lightning round. This gentleman here in the glasses has his hand up for a while.
In 2002, we voted to change the mayoral system to a strong mayor. And unfortunately, both administrations have ended with the federal law enforcement having to step in. So I'm wondering where each candidate stands on whether we need structural reforms, other than getting yourself elected, and that would fix everything. But what structural reforms do you think we need to safeguard the city from a third administration?
Wow. Does anybody have an answer to that question? Go ahead, Mr. Cruz.
You know, from my end, I would say that I think it's unfair to judge that system based on personal decisions that the past two administrations have made. I wouldn't want to jump into conclusion and say the system doesn't work when we've never really had a mayor that takes that job or that responsibility as serious to answering to the people of Hartford. So I don't want to be the one saying change the system, because at the end of the day, we've actually never had an opportunity to have someone who could do the job from day one to the last day in office.
I agree with that. A strong mayor system of government only works if you have a strong mayor who is willing to hold himself or herself accountable. Now, the beauty to me of a strong mayor form of government is it puts authority and accountability in the same place. In other words, you have the power as a strong mayor to make a change. And if you don't make that change, then the voters have a power to make a change. And that's what's valuable about it. It allows for somebody in that position to say, here are my priorities, and then to have no excuses when they get into that office about going after them. So I support a strong mayor form of government, but I think it takes a manager and a leader who's going to be engaged in the daily management of City Hall, who's going to pay attention to the small things, not just the big things, and who's going to govern not just by press release, but by active, constant daily management.
I am going to take my... I'm sorry? The question it was, given that the last two administrations have ended with law enforcement, right. Is there a change that you, do you think that it's appropriate to make a change in the form of government at this time, or how to address that to avoid that happening again?
No, and I heard a couple of the answers. I mean, no, strong mayor for government is fine, okay? Again, you know, Luke said if you have a strong mayor, someone who's going to manage properly, but... The accountability portion comes from checks and balances, okay? Not, I want to do this, and then city council rubber stamps it through, and nobody blinks an eye. That's the key to accountability, is having checks and balances. And that's why I think the one-party government in Hartford is broken, and it's not working. And so that's why I'm asking for bipartisan leadership.
So now we're going to, because we're going a little over time, and we're going to head for the lightning round. And in order, going back to Reverend Smith's comment about marinating, I'm going to give you a few seconds to think about the answer to this question. And then each of you has to answer this question in one sentence. And again, we're going to make sure that that sentence is not a run-on sentence that goes on for too long. So the question is... What is your vision for the city of Hartford? And I will ask you to answer it in a minute, in 30 seconds, but I'm going to tell you then who gets to go first.
All right. I don't know if that was 30 seconds, but it's close enough, right? So the first person to answer is going to be Mr. Cannon.
My vision for the city of Hartford is, as I stated earlier, a place where our children, our children are the most important thing in this election, I believe, okay? Because it's the future of Hartford. Okay, all right. Sorry. My vision for the city of Hartford is a place where our children will be proud residents in the future.
Thank you. Councilman Cruz.
My vision for the city of Hartford is whether you go to the north, the south, the west of Hartford, that we are able to truly say we're one city, one Hartford.
Thank you. Mr. Bronin.
A city on the rise where everyone in the city shares in Hartford's rise.
All right. And Reverend Smith.
Economic equality for all people in the city of Hartford. And that's my vision for all the people in the city of Hartford, to come together and we all work together and make this city better.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you to the four of you for having the courage to undertake running for mayor, for imagining yourself in the role of mayor. And thank you all here coming this evening. Your participation is really important. I apologize to those of you who wanted to ask a question and I couldn't get everybody to ask questions because we didn't have enough time. But please come to the next event next week, Thursday, and please do not forget to fill out the orange form to say whether you thought this was a good way to do this. Thank you all very much and have a good evening.